Welcome to Upward Bound. I'm Arthur Johnson, and here we are going to address issues related to poverty and homelessness. Today, our guest is Dnarius Lewis. Welcome, Dnarius.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you for being here. Dnarius is an author, public speaker, and entrepreneur. He's also a formerly homeless person, what we like to call on the show, street survivors. Dnarius, I mentioned that you are an author. You have two books, one of them called The Power of the Subconscious Mind, which I've read and I liked. And you have a second book called The Essence of Inspiration.
Correct.
Who inspires you?
The people who inspire me on a daily basis are people I come across. My director of communication, Elizabeth Faison, and then a lot of my friends who support me in my journey.
Okay. Now, one of the things that, as we said, we're talking about poverty and homelessness, and one of the things you said you were formerly homeless. Now, you were originally from Memphis, is that correct?
Correct.
And then when you moved, you were homeless when you came to Minnesota?
So just to give a recap, so I grew up in, I was raised in Memphis, Tennessee, grew up in Minnesota.
Okay.
After I graduated high school in 2011, I decided to go to college.
Okay.
I wanted to go out of state, so I went to school in Iowa.
Okay.
I was grateful to be a part of two national champion teams wrestling cross country.
Nice.
After suffering my ninth concussion in wrestling, I said, I'm done trying to be this macho guy. After running, doing cross country and getting tendonitis in both knees, we were running 90 miles a week. And so I was like, all right, I'm beating my body up. There has to be something else out here. So I eventually transferred to Sierra Nevada College in Lake Tahoe. The school was very unaffordable. It was $44,000 a year. Mm. I only could survive there a semester. And then within that transfer, my family had decided to move back to Tennessee. So I had no family in Minnesota, but Minnesota was home to me.
Okay.
So I had met a friend in Nevada, and he said, hey, you can come back to Minnesota. You can stay with me. I said, all right, cool. I'm going to go visit my family, and I'll be up there. Well, I visit family, I came back, and he thought I just wanted to come party. And I was like, no, I need a place until I get into school. Well, he said, this is not gonna work. So I was left homeless. I was outside in front of his house. I didn't have a car license or permit to get around. And all I had was an iPhone. And I sent out a tweet, and an old family friend that knew me through the wrestling community, they said, hey, Dnarius, you can come stay with us. I just had to find a way to get there.
Mm-hmm.
They lived in Prior Lake. I don't know where I was at that point in Minnesota. Mm-hmm. Some friends picked me up. They dropped me off. And the people I stayed with, they gave me an opportunity to, they gave me a room, a basement, and I could stay there as long as I want. I got accepted to every school in Minnesota, but I didn't have a car license permit to get around.
Right.
And then I eventually transferred to St. Cloud. And I had another journey of being homeless up there too, while I was getting out of school and just trying to make it happen, trying to make life work.
Okay. One of the things I noticed that you're a public speaker, so mostly your speeches are motivational then? Is that what your focus is?
It really depends the topic. So I do have a role in the activism where I speak on, generational poverty, how do we overcome this? A lot of my speeches are on how to overcome adversity, the power of positive thinking and gratitude. I believe we all go through times in our life, but it's how we view those times to see, hey, there's another way out of it.
Mm-hmm.
And so how do we move forward if we're not grateful for where we're at to where we want to go?
Going on that, I know one of the big controversial issues that happened earlier this year, a member of President Trump's cabinet, Dr. Ben Carson.
Yes.
He, and I don't know how he, he tried to come up with this analogy that... the thing that people who were in public housing, it was all about attitude. And like the right attitude would, people were in that situation, they're in poverty because of their attitude, which I don't know if that's true or not. But what would you say to that? I mean, when you heard those words that he was saying.
I believe it was a very blatant, just disrespectful towards his own community.
Mm-hmm.
It's not an attitude. It is actually systematically oppression that has led people through poverty.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, ghettos are actually constructed on purpose. We have redistricting, redlining, all these different things in the political sector where, if you don't have a certain, if you're not in a certain tax bracket, you're going to live in a certain neighborhood.
Right.
And so even if you are in that tax bracket, you're beat up systematically if you're trying to progress. If I look at certain areas that are, defined the ghetto,
mm-hmm.
there's not many jobs, there's not many opportunities. And when people grow up in that generationally, how are they actually going to see something different if they see no different around them?
Right. And one of the things, you mentioned about yourself going to different colleges or whatever. Myself, I've got an economics degree, and I've wrote a lot about homelessness. And one of the things I've been a strong believer, and I want to see what you think, is that one of the keys to people ascending their way out of poverty is education.
Uh-huh.
because many of the jobs, I mean, everyone loves to point to the low unemployment rate, but many of those jobs do not provide a living wage. And so it's very hard to, you know, without benefits, without insurance, access to childcare, access to transportation, which you indicate hindered your ability to move upward. How would you feel education plays a role in this?
Education is a key role. The problem with education, it's unaffordable. If we were going to college, is at times not a reality to many. And so one thing I've always stressed is self-education. We're in a time right now in the 2018s and forward that we have a lot of people who are being self-taught. They pick up books, self-learning. Transformational learning is what I was taught, is how do you self-educate yourself if you can't afford education? And when I was in my lowest in my life, I had a mentor that I ran across. Her name was Mary Dingman. I ran to her when I picked up a book. The book was called Branding Yourself by Cal Lacey and Eric Deckers. It says, do what professionals do, go where professionals go, and wear what professionals wear. And the place that I resonated in that book was the Chambers of Commerce. Well, I was at that time 20, not just left college. I had to stop going to school because when I was in school, I had to get a job to stay afloat, and I survived the summer 2013 with only $1.78. So I was like, I'm struggling, I'm sick of this oppression, or how would I actually get out of this?
Yep.
And I picked up a book, started doing the steps the book told me to go, and I started to really understand that if I can't afford to go back to school, I'm sure I can find a way to really self-educate myself. And when I started to get that confidence that a lot of the authors put into you with these self-help books, I started to say, hey, there's no different for me writing my own book, doing my own journey, and rewriting this journey that I want to obviously write.
Okay. And mentioning that with that philosophy, I'm glad because we're not going to discuss the minimum wage.
Yeah.
It's a big issue. You're in the Twin Cities.
Yes.
Minneapolis is right now on a progressive path to move toward a $15 minimum wage. That is currently an issue here in St. Paul.
Correct.
Mayor Carter made it the centerpiece of his economic agenda. And we'll start off by looking at this issue called the tip credit. How do you think that's going to play into it? Do you think is it necessary to have that?
The tip credit, there's mixed reviews on it, but I've seen the genuine non-benefits of a tip credit because if you're a waiter, a waitress, whatever field that is, you shouldn't have your tips taken away. And that's really what the waitresses and waiters are fighting for is that, hey, we want to take control of our tips. Mm-hmm. We don't want to have a cap on our tips, and we don't want our tips to be redistributed back to us when they should be ours in the first place, because it's really up to the owner to actually say, hey, we'll give you the tips. If we don't, we're going to put this into our business to redevelop the business. Well, that's what profits are for. That's what revenue is for, not from the revenue that these hardworking waitresses and waiters are ultimately looking to get.
Now, one of the things when you look at the increase in minimum wage, the fight over it, a lot of the small business community is very much up in arms about it.
Yes, they are.
And one of the things I've always been concerned about, if you remember back when President Obama put forth this Affordable Care Act, which I thought was fantastic. Mm-hmm. I was very happy about it. It was one of the big reasons I voted for him. But when that got put into place, a lot of employers looked at the regulations and they adjusted their policies to try to avoid it. Mm-hmm. So if it said 30, they would put the people at 28 hours. If they had to have 50 employees, they'd cut you off at 49. Mm-hmm. They took any and every measure to make sure that they stayed under the limit that they had to be at to have to follow that law. Are you afraid that this might happen if the higher minimum wage goes into place?
I do see that plays some effects because I've even seen customers go into restaurants and say, oh, if this person gets $15 an hour, I don't need to tip. Well, $15, for those that live on $15 an hour, no, that's still not enough to even live because rents are rising.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the cost of insurance for cars, health, and all these other things, sometimes those $15 hour jobs really don't even actually provide those. And so when I see that play out here in St. Paul or even nationally, it's really the business that really should support their customer base, but they all should support also the people who are working for them. So as an employer, you should really support your employees because if you treat your employees right, they ultimately will treat the business right.
Okay. One of the things I'm concerned about too is not just as far as adjustment there, but also if let's say you're getting 30 hours a week and you're getting $10 an hour, which, okay, it might be a little bit lower now because I think it's 11 a quarter right now in Minneapolis. Mm-hmm. But if it goes to the $15, I'm thinking that the people who run these companies, you know, the people in the big office towers in Minneapolis, They're smart people.
Yes, they are.
They're not going to, you know, take a loss or whatever. They're going to, I'm thinking they're going to juggle numbers so that, and what I'm afraid of is that you might want, a person with $15 an hour might see less a hour. Reduction in hours.
Correct.
Now, one thing I've told people, and I want to see what you think of it, I write for a paper in Washington, D.C. They passed theirs a few years ago. And one of the things I told my readers was, focus your job search on part-time jobs. Try to put together 2 or 3 part, you know, 20-hour jobs. You'll be able to take full advantage of this. Versus if you try to go out and get a 40-hour job, nobody's, unless you have a college degree mm-hmm. or a wealth of experience, you're going to be searching for a job for a long time. What do you think of that philosophy?
I agree because I went to school, but I had to stop because I couldn't afford to stay in school. Mm-hmm. I've had 23 jobs. I'm 25 at this point. So I understand that struggle of trying to do the part-time, half-time, full-time. Mm-hmm. And I currently have a job. I work as an overnight PCA. So I just got off work at 9 a.m. this morning. Mm-hmm. I go back tonight at 9 p.m. And that's not the only job. I'm also a part-time basketball coach at the YMCA.
Okay.
I'm also a referee. I've sat on a couple boards as well. So with all these different activities I've had to learn with you, what you're saying, it's a reality that many would have to really face. It's that grind, that paycheck, that lifestyle to overcome that paycheck to paycheck.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you work a job just to stay afloat, but the job still doesn't keep you afloat. And so that analogy is what we're really trying to end by. Even, you know, $15 an hour is a great, it's great because it's getting us to that point, but we really need to continue to grow because in America, we are the most prosperous country generally in the world.
Right.
A lot of our dollars are being financially pushed in so many different negligent ways. It's not really at times going back to the community, it's going back to the corporations. At times, the people's pockets as well who run those corporations. And so when I see that these bigger companies are not willing to budge at mm-hmm. really helping people stay afloat and actually live comfortably and have basic human rights and needs,
mm-hmm.
I mean, Amazon just finally put their minimum wage to $15 an hour. But it's also the wealthiest business ever.
Mm-hmm.
He just hit $1 trillion before Apple hit $1 trillion.
Yep.
He's the wealthiest man literally in the world, and he can't yes. afford to pay people $15 an hour. It makes no sense. But that's what greed and all the disattachment to what America really is, which is empowering people from all walks to really try to live, because we don't make it out of here alive, but we might as well enjoy the journey while we're here.
Okay. One of the things I wanted to ask you about, I remember a few years ago there was I know there's been a number of rallies around the Twin Cities, and there was one in North Minneapolis right on, I believe, West Broadway. I believe they were right in front of where the Wendy's and Taco Bell, right, 94. And they yep. were, one of the things I remember someone mentioned, it was like a quote or whatever, they were, I think they referenced to the downtown Minneapolis buildings, and they were saying, we want what they've got.
Yes.
Referring to like the salary and benefits or whatever. Now, one might also argue that many, like I mentioned about education being important, many people who make good money have invested their time and money in college. I mean, how do you balance? Because like you mentioned with, you know, you're an entrepreneur. Entrepreneurs, obviously, you know, yes, you're right. A lot of them make a lot of money and maybe some of them keep too much to themselves, but they also take an enormous amount of risk. What would you say to that?
The biggest risk in life is the risk that we're not willing to take or okay. even make. So for any entrepreneur that makes 7 figures a year,
mm-hmm.
you can give some of that to either nonprofits or even rebuilding the communities that are less really benefited from it. So if I look at the individuals who are entrepreneurs who make, let's say, $1 million a year,
mm-hmm.
well, that's just in one bracket. There's people who make more than that and
yes.
because oh, yeah. there's this passive income.
Right.
And I know a couple of my friends who have sold their business for $171 million.
Okay.
This is a St. Paul-based company. I won't put the name out.
Okay.
And given that person, you know, gave up their business and they had the share dock, but they still took in over $35 million.
Okay.
Well, that $35 million, you're set. Your family
Correct.
Is set.
Yes.
How can you give back your time? Because now you don't have to trade time for money
yes.
and helping others educate themselves to actually know the empowerment of financial literacy. If we look at these communities that are really struggling financially, spiritually, and mentally, it comes mm-hmm. down to the lack of finances. People at times who are struggling paycheck to paycheck, they don't know how to actually manage their money because they're not having enough money. They don't, you know, if you have a fixed income, your food choices are actually not applicable to really actually hone in on your health. There's food deserts in North Minneapolis. There's only one genuine place to shop there, which is that Cub Foods right off that Broadway.
Yep.
There's fast foods all around there. And if I go to an Edina, a Wayzata, a Minnetonka, I live in St. Louis Park, I have a Whole Foods here, I have an LA Fitness here, I have a Cuff Foods here, I have a Jerry's. There's all these different options, especially organic options, to really help the community thrive. But if I look at like certain nonprofits in Minneapolis that generate over $200 million, if you donate to that nonprofit, you have a choice of where that money goes to, in which communities. Well, we know that generationally wise, though, that those who donate to those nonprofits, they get to choose the neighborhoods. And those neighborhoods are typically the neighborhoods they live in. The Wayzatas, the Edinas, the Minnetonkas, which at times there's not many people of color or minorities in that gyps. Yep. And so it's say, hey, how can we really help people outside of our community? Because Minnesota as a whole is still our community as a whole.
Yes. And, you know, it's interesting you're mentioning about, like, one of the things that people always talk about is, like, with McDonald's.
Correct.
That's always one of the most referenced ones. And one of the things that McDonald's, and I think Amazon too, but not as much, but McDonald's and Walmart, the two most named in this, is that one of the big things that people always complain about is that many of their employees are the taxpayers. You know, sure, they like say, oh, you know, they don't want the minimum wage raise, but they're in essence subsidizing those companies, because those are two of the companies where they have the largest, I think it was like 52%, I heard, of the employees there are on some sort of government assistance, whether it's food stamps, Medicaid, stuff like that. So, and these are companies that do make good profits. Now, with Walmart, they have less of a reason to be defensive. McDonald's, you know, the problem with that people don't seem to understand is that McDonald's, yes, it's a kind of a villain company, but 90% of the franchise or of the restaurants are franchises.
Correct.
So there's a third party involved. People seem to think, oh, the McDonald's CEO could just snap his fingers and increase the minimum wage. He can only do it for about 10% of the company. Walmart owns all their own stores.
Yes, they do.
Which is really atrocious that how they, but they haven't been raising their wages lately. But when you look at how the, you know, with government assistance, I mean, don't you just find it really horrible that they do? I mean, McDonald's, I think you heard about this, but they actually had a like a phone center for their employees, and it was advising them to like apply for Medicaid or all this kind of, take a second job, all these kind of things, instead of just paying people more. Like trying to point all these different avenues.
And when you point them to those avenues, they get blamed for being on assistance. That they're they're blamed for being lazy. It's like a cycle that never ends. My mother has been working for Walmart for 20 years. So I grew up in Walmart. I grew up with hearing the struggles of working for Walmart. And till this day, she's looking to get out of Walmart. But it's like, I can't really leave because I'm still barely even getting the hours from Walmart because they're cutting back. The minimum wage is being raised. But as you're aging, because my mother's in her late 50s, they're not going to pay a person in their late 50s adequate pay compared to a person who's 18 years old, coming out of college, or whatever the gyps of those who apply for Walmart. I mean, the wage is going to be cut because of age. We can't stop us from aging, but we still should be taken care of by the company that we've given half our life for. I mean, if we're going to retire for a company, we should get a pension that we've set aside within that organization, not a fancy watch or a pat on the back or, hey, thank you for your service, go on with yourself, and just being replaced. And a lot of these other big time companies like a Walmart, a McDonald's, they're really replacing their employees with machines now, because they don't want to pay people. Yeah. So it's like, well, you don't want to pay people, but you want to create a bigger solution, a bigger problem to a solution that all you have to do is just treat your employees as you would want to be treated. And we wouldn't have these problems of protests, because there's a lot of protests with McDonald's recently. People are protesting left and right with Walmart. And the problem with Walmart and these big corporations, they really hurt and hinder small business. So it's really hard for any entrepreneur to really come up in that same type of a merchant type business unless you're doing it online. And one thing that Amazon has done that really is hindered the progression of Walmart's online company is because Walmart admitted they were late on the game of building their online e-commerce. They were so late that they can't even really keep up, and that the person who actually exceeded behind all of them has obviously been Amazon. But Amazon has its hiccups because they're not paying their people. Walmart's not paying their people. And then McDonald's is being franchised. And even though it's franchised, they can do something as a company policies, company minimums. And these companies have so much power politically because there are super PACs. You know, we know all those different things.
Yes.
They just have to really start caring. And that's where we're losing. We're losing the fight is where these companies that we are trading our time, our health and wealth, and they're not caring, even though they care more about the dollar sign than the people who are helping them create that dollar sign.
One thing I know, as I mentioned, with in Washington, D.C., when Walmart was, when they were doing their minimum wage raise, and I haven't heard of this happening here in the Twin Cities, although it could, but I know one of the big issues there was that Walmart was at the time moving into the area. They actually were threatening the city council. There was they were going to have three stores built, mm-hmm. 3 to 6 or whatever, and they were threatening to pull out if they didn't. Do you see this something that might happen, and do you worry that large companies who have the clout to really frighten politicians will try to use that economic machine that they've created where they have a lot of people, and, you know, a company like Walmart, it's not only just the jobs they provide, but also the fact that they lower costs literally for the people, because even if you're, you know, not making much money, if you are a person in poverty, at least with Walmart, you can afford to feed yourself pretty good. Their prices are decent.
Yep.
But do you worry a company might try to do something like that?
I know the companies do that. And when Amazon wanted to make Minneapolis their headquarters here, mm-hmm. they didn't like the politics that they wanted tax benefits. They wanted a tax break. You guys make $1 trillion. You don't need a tax break. And they chose not to use Minnesota as a hub, mm-hmm. even though Minnesota is a really big component to support Amazon. There's Amazon location. And I used to work for Amazon. I'm an ex-employee of Amazon, so this is not just me reading the politics. I used to work there. I was an employee for a while.
Okay.
And when I started to see the dangers of even working in those warehouses and mm-hmm. people not getting work comp, the company not caring when there's so many packages, there's packages falling on people. And it's like these big companies are just really building their financial dollar signs off the backs of hardworking Americans. And they don't care what race you are, they just want you to put you in there, work here for $10 and less mm-hmm. because they want more profit for their own monetary gain. And so I've seen that play out in so many different companies behind the scenes because Minnesota is a great place. It's the Midwest of it's deemed the New York of the Midwest.
Yep.
But even in that, we're still lacking a lot of the structure that really would hinder us, that would actually not hinder us, improve this economic that we have right here in Minneapolis. If I look at, statistics have shown Minnesota is the best place to raise a family, mm-hmm. but it has the highest disparities.
Yes.
So who's the families that are being actually benefited behind this title, and who's are actually being hindered? If we look at the statistics behind of home ownership,
mm-hmm.
there's not even a 1% of African Americans or minorities that actually have home ownership here in the Twin Cities. I looked at one of the statistics for the average household for Caucasians, it's 172,000. For African Americans, it's 28,000. For Mexican Americans, it's 11,000. So systematically, it shows you the breakdown of who's actually benefiting this financially and generationally from all these different businesses that come in and come out. Mm-hmm. It's not a win-win for many people who aren't of the European descent, but it's like, mm-hmm. how can we really actually make Minnesota whole and make Minnesota great? Because I love the state. It's where I grew up, and it's where I choose to live and ultimately raise a family. But if I know that systematically I'm going to be a part of the system mm-hmm. that will not prevail, it will actually take me and make me go elsewhere. A couple of years ago, Star Tribune came out with an article that showed a lot of minority business owners not being they would leave as they built a business in Minnesota within mm-hmm. the first 5 years. And after the 5 years, a lot of minority business owners, they went back to the South. They went to the Atlantas, the Floridas, the Tennessees, the Nashvilles. And I've had friends actually leave this market mm-hmm. and actually go to Atlanta. And for me to see their success down in Atlanta made me actually question my own success. Is Minnesota hindering me and my progression because of my skin tone or whatever that may look like? And that's one of the things I've seen here trying to really change the culture that Minnesota has.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's interesting. You mentioned about how Minnesota has been ranked as one of the best places to raise a family. And part of that, I think, is because we have, like you took take childcare. You know, we have almost 2 dozen Fortune 500 headquarters here in the mm-hmm. Minneapolis-St. Paul area. You got companies like General Mills, 3M. Mm-hmm. What's interesting, though, is that many of the people at those headquarter buildings, you know, they have, I believe, childcare facilities right on the premises.
Yep.
And these are people who make very good salaries who could afford childcare in another place, but, you know, they got right there. And then you have other people who work at, you know, the McDonald's, the Walmarts, or whatever, and they can't afford childcare. And so it's kind of like, it's really weird. The people who can get good childcare, whose employer provides it, these people could afford to get it on their own. you know, don't have to worry about that. And then the people who really have to worry about it have no other option.
Correct. And I've had that that situation become a reality in my own family, because I come from the generation of working for those big corporations in Walmart. Mm-hmm. I'm the only person in my family who has not worked at Walmart. My sister has worked at Walmart. Both my sisters have worked at Walmart and at Sam's Club, and my mom has worked at Sam's Club. And I'm like, these are big corporations that have enough room to make a big aisle for basketballs, but you can't knock a section out and make a child care for the employees there, because it's a big warehouse. It's a big building. You can make sections like they've done it to sell stuff, mm-hmm. but they're also going to help keep the retention of their employees if they were to actually treat their employees just a little bit better and actually give them the access as childcare would.
Okay. Now, I mentioned earlier about you have a book mm-hmm. come out, The Essence of Inspiration. When is that going to be released?
The book will be released November 15th. I will be having a release party. Those that are looking to find news and keep updates to that, just follow me on dnariuslewis.com. I also have a book called The Power of the Subconscious Mind. You can find that right now as well on Amazon, Barnes & Noble. And so the book will be coming out November 15th.
Okay. And it'll be available, it's like Amazon, Barnes & Noble, and you'll have it on Kindle and Nook?
Correct.
Okay. Excellent. Well, thank you, Dnarius, for being on the show.
Thank you.
It's been a pleasure. And thank you, everyone, for watching Upward Bound.
Thank you.